There were three stages, I think, in my becoming an intactivist, starting from the age of four. I'm the youngest of three children. I have an older brother and an older sister. My dad was a doctor. I never knew him because he was killed in the Second World War when I was 4 months old. All I know about this thing was that when I was about four or five and having a bath with mother bathing me and my brother, I noticed that his penis was different from mine. And obviously, as you do, I thought there was something wrong with his penis. So I asked my mother why it was like that. And she explained to me that I'd had an operation and had a piece of skin removed from my penis because it was a bit tight, I think I was told. And that he hadn't had this done. And then she added, your father didn't approve of it. Even though I was a very young child at the time, I think this, well, I've always remembered that ever since. It's always been in the back of my mind that it was something which I suppose I sensed was controversial even then. I didn't think much more about it. Quite a lot of the boys at school were circumcised. I think it was about 50-50. I took up medicine like everyone, all the other people in my family. One of my teachers in Cambridge was a man called Douglas Gairdner, who had written a paper published many years before I met him. It was published in 1949, called Fate of the Foreskin, which was very influential on the history of circumcision, in at least in Britain, perhaps in some other English-speaking countries. As a result, I think, of his studies, circumcision was not taken up by the National Health Service in Britain when it was set up. And then, as you do, I went on to be a junior doctor, and I did some surgery. I wasn't destined to become a surgeon, but in the training system, you had to do 6 months of surgical training, whatever branch of medicine you're going to do. And so one day I was in an operating theatre as the most junior medical person there, with all these more senior people to meet. And they wheel in a child, I think 5, 6, 7-year-old boy, and anaesthetized, and they say, oh, this boy's going to have a circumcision. And they tell me I'm to do it. So I carry out the circumcision, being told what to do by the senior doctors, surgeons there. You know, cut here, put a stitch in, do this, do that. And this was the first time, really, I think, that I had seen a foreskin and completely unraveled it to see how big it was, how much tissue there was. This was, I think, my next, if you like, epiphany or awakening after the moment in the bath when I was about four or five, was doing this circumcision and seeing, and this was perfectly normal, healthy tissue. I could see that. It wasn't diseased in any way. And I thought, we shouldn't really be doing this. This looks, you know, this looks right. I didn't say anything to my senior colleagues. Obviously, you didn't argue with them. Not in those days. But I thought very hard about what I was doing. I didn't like it, and I was thinking all the time, somebody did this to me. And I think I had a few sleepless nights after that. It just, you know, I'd seen lots of other operations, you know, all the common things, appendix and hernias and all this, and they hadn't bothered me. But this circumcision really upset me, I think, that we were doing this thing to this normal-looking boy's penis. And it struck me that it was a bit like taking a little rosebud that hasn't opened and peeling off all the petals and so on, and just spoiling it. And I never forgot that. I never did another circumcision. And then the next job I did after the surgical job was in pediatrics. And that was in 1968. And I was studying for a pediatric exam. So I was reading all the literature as it appeared in the library and going through back copies of the pediatric journals. And in the summer of 1968 appeared in the latest copy of the Archives of Diseases of Childhood a paper by a Danish doctor called Jacob Oster, further fate of the foreskin, and it was a continuation of the study which had been done by Douglas Gairdner. Douglas Gairdner had only studied what happens with the development of the foreskin up to about the age of 4 years, and this Danish doctor, Oster, had pursued the fate of the foreskin, how it develops, right through to age 18, I think, to virtually to adult life. Whereas Gairdner's paper had shown that at the age of, I think I'm quoting it right, 4 years old, about 10% of foreskins could still not be retracted. Oster continued to observe these Danish boys beyond that, and it didn't intervene, they weren't circumcised, and he showed, as far as I recall, that it was about 1% was still not able to retract by the age of 17 or 18. In other words, that of the 10% that were perhaps Gairdner may have thought were abnormal, the vast majority of them actually did continue to develop and become normal and retract properly. And I read this paper in 1968 and thought, well, that's a very important finding. And of course, it won't be necessary to do all these circumcisions like the one I'd done a few months earlier. You don't need to do that on boys at this age. If you just leave them alone, they'll come right. And I thought, well, circumcision will obviously disappear now after this. It's not necessary. If we had a boy, should he be circumcised? And I said, no, definitely not. He shouldn't be done. It should be left alone, natural. So, but in fact, we had daughters. But if they had been boys, there's no question they would have been left alone. I was getting middle-aged, and I became aware that really I had very little feeling in my own penis, that it was very insensitive, that during sex, I didn't really know what was happening down there. You couldn't feel very much at all. I couldn't. And I thought, this can't be right, that the front end of the penis, which is supposed to be so sensitive, really has no sensation in it. Why is this? You know, this nature can't have intended that. And then, of course, I thought back, yeah, yes, well, circumcision. That's the reason. It must be. It can be the only explanation that I have no feeling in the glands of the penis, that it's so insensitive, and that the other parts of the penis were a bit more sensitive, but the front end, it really had no feeling in it at all. And I got quite upset about this. I thought, does anyone else know this? Are people aware of this? And I started to look in the medical literature. Very difficult to find at that stage anything much that had been published about what the foreskin was for, about feeling in it or anything like this. It was just around that time, 1993, I opened my ordinary daily newspaper one day, and there was a review of by the medical correspondent, I think, of the newspaper, about a book which had been published in California. It was a long article about this book, about foreskin restoration, and that there were men in California who had been circumcised and weren't happy with this result, and I think he probably talked about sensation and so on, and that they were stretching the skin to get it to cover the glands again. And I thought this was great interest. I wrote off to America and sent some dollars and said, please send me your book. And so in due course the book arrived. I didn't know quite what to expect. I thought, maybe this is some cranky thing, this is just, you know, it'll be nonsense. But when I opened the book, I immediately saw that this was a scholarly work, properly researched, very well referenced, written by a man who'd obviously thought very deeply about this and considered it at length. And so having read the book, which really sort of echoed my own feelings. A lot of the stuff in it echoed my own feelings, which I had thought privately for some time, that the foreskin was an important organ, that it had sensation and so on, that it was there for a purpose. And I mean, I'm a great believer in evolution, and that, you know, in my study of the human body, there's always a reason for a structure being present. It has a function. Sometimes we're, you know, scientists are not always clear what the reason is, but I'm sure there is a reason. Evolution doesn't mess about making stupid mistakes. And obviously the foreskin is there for a reason, and if it isn't in the medical textbooks, it's just because it hasn't been discovered or investigated or reported. But surely it has a function. And I'd been thinking this for a long time, and obviously its function was to do with sensation as much as anything. And then when I read this book by Bigelow, it echoed my thoughts, it expanded them. There was a lot more there than things which I hadn't thought about, the rolling action of the extra skin on the penis, well, I say extra skin, the normal skin on the penis, during intercourse and so on, which of course I'd never experienced. And so I was, this was the sort of third awakening, really, was Jim Bigelow's book. And this was the final one, really. And I was so intrigued by this book that I telephoned Mr. Bigelow and had a long talk with him on the telephone. Lengthy transatlantic telephone calls took place. And then I said, well, you know, I think I need to come over to California and meet you, because there's nobody in Britain who is aware of this, what you're doing, and I want to come and meet you. So a few months later, I did come over to San Francisco. It was the first time I'd been to the United States. I met Jim Bigelow and a number of other people involved in the anti-circumcision or the circumcision foreskin restoration movement. I became aware of the important work which was going on here in with regard to preventing circumcision and to helping men who have been circumcised. And so when I left, I said, look, if you get other British men contacting you about this subject, you know, by all means put them in touch with me. I'm a doctor. I'm quite happy to take calls about this sort of thing. And so then gradually over the next few months, I started getting letters and telephone calls from men. Not very often, but they were coming through. And I would have these men saying, I've never talked to anybody about this before. And but this is what's happened to me. I was circumcised when I was a child, and this is how it's affected me. And there was they'd never talked to anyone before, and yet their stories all, to a large extent, overlapped. They were consistent with one another. There was obviously a sort of, what we might call in medical terms, a sort of post-circumcision syndrome, almost, of symptoms, which were, I kept hearing them again and again. They were complaining that loss of feeling, usually loss of sexual feeling anyway. Some men would say their clothing rubbed and they had unpleasant sensation. They lacked normal enjoyable sensations from the penis during sex, but they would have discomfort from clothing rubbing. Others would say they were so ashamed, they were deeply ashamed of the fact that they had been mutilated. They felt mutilated. They were so ashamed they wouldn't undress, usually in front of other men. They were more ashamed in front of men than women very often. Although some were so ashamed in front of any person that they were quite unable to have any sort of sexual contact because they were so deeply ashamed of what had been done to them. But many would say, well, you know, I won't go in a changing room. I've stopped doing sport. I can't risk anyone seeing me in a shower or anything like that because they're so ashamed of the mutilated genital, really. And so I contacted these people I was in touch with and said, would you like to come to a meeting about circumcision? Because there are quite a number of men now who've been contacting me, and I think this meeting took place, and I think we had about 20 men there, roughly. I can't remember exactly how many. And I just let each one tell his story around the room. And it was a very moving experience because, I mean, I'd heard their stories before, but of course they hadn't. And it was just an electric sort of atmosphere in the room. I'd never seen anything like it, really. And out of this, I said at the end, shall we have another meeting? Do you want to meet again? Do you want to talk about restoration? And of course, most of them did. And so that's how Norm UK was born, really. We ran support groups to help men who wanted to restore. But of course, you couldn't just confine your activities to foreskin restoration. They all wanted to say, how can we stop this happening to the next generation?